how you can make the Word of God flesh to you. I promised you last week that this morning I will finish the series we began on New Year's Eve when the Lord brought a word out to us as to what to expect this year. He said that this will be the year of His glorious grace, the year to be still and to see the salvation of God, the year to see His deliverance, to see His prosperity, to see His health, to see His mind, the soundness of His mind on you, in you, the year of protection, the year of safety, in fact, the year of wholeness. He said also this is going to be the year of the sudden manifestation of the promises of God, the year you will say, and it came to pass. He then said it's a year of increased and sharper discernment to help us recognize the work of grace in our lives. The year of a sharper discernment of the Spirit for us to be able to know and recognize the work of God's grace in our lives. And then finally, he said, it's the year of the sensitivity to the Holy Spirit, which comes by us feeding on the food that will feed our spirit man, which of course is the Word of God. So therefore, this is the year to study the Word, read the Word, hear the Word, speak the Word, and believe the Word more than ever. If you understand, I say amen.
Amen.
And then that was New Year's Eve service. Then on the following day, which happened to be the first day of the year, which happened to be also be Sunday, we began the series of the end times. And today, as I said, is the last day of the teaching on this end times, at least for right now. And we began by talking about the rapture. And we said to you that the rapture, according to the Word of God, is God's blessed hope that Christ, our Lord Jesus, will return for the church. For those of us who are believers, who are part of the church, that Christ will return for us. And He will also resurrect the dead and transport the living believers, you and I, to be with Himself while the world endures the great tribulation. So God promises us that He will send Jesus and He will return. When He returns, only the church will see Him. When He returns, only the church will get a chance to go up to be with Him. And those that have died in Christ Jesus, He will resurrect those people, and we will all then go up to be with Him. And after our departure, then the world will go through 7 years of what is called Great Tribulation. But the Great Tribulation does not start until the rapture begins. Now, so then, for the rapture to occur, certain things had to be in place for the rapture to occur. And everything that is supposed to be in place has already happened. The first one is the regathering of the people, of the Jewish people, the regathering of them around the world to return to the land, the promised land called Israel. That is one evidence or proof that we are truly in the last days, and that the events that have to occur in order for the rapture to occur, they have already happened. One is, I said, the regathering of the Jewish people around the world to return to their land called Israel. Now, we can look at the book of Isaiah chapter 11, verses 10 to 12. We're going to read that, Isaiah 11, 10 through 12. And as we look at that, I mentioned to you before that indeed God uses the Jewish people or the land of Israel or Israel as the measuring rod, his timetable, his clock for dealing with the rest of the world. So if you really want to know how is it that God sees the world, you got to see it through God's eyes, in this case through how he deals with Israel. So God's dealing with Israel is how he deals with the rest of mankind in history. And I'll explain to you why in a minute. But in Isaiah 11, verse 10, and in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for an ensign. An ensign means a flag or a symbol, as an ensign of the people. To it shall the Gentiles seek, and his rest shall be glorious. Next verse. And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time. He says again the second time. So that was the first time. He set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people, which shall be left from Assyria and from Egypt and from Patros and from Cush and from Elam. In fact, let me go through it. From Assyria is where today you will have place where it used to be called Nineveh, which today is called Mosul. I'm sure you heard it on the news, Mosul. That is the area where the Assyrian kingdom was located. As I said, now it's called Mosul. It used to be called Nineveh. And then from Egypt, we know, and from Patros, this is an island, and from Cush, which is Egypt, from Elam, which is Iran, and from Shinar, which is Babylon or Iraq and Hamath, and from the islands of the sea, which really refers to all nations. So God will bring them from all nations. Verse 12, and he shall set up an ensign or flag for the nations and shall assemble the outcasts of Israel and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. And so God says he will do it, and indeed he has done it. And it says that they have brought all of them from all over the world back to the land. The second thing that we need to mention is the establishment of Israel itself. And he brought them back, but the nation was established. Remember, I read to you the scripture in Isaiah, where can a nation be born in a day? And it happened on that day when the United Nations made a declaration or a resolution that Israel would become a state. And was May 14, 1948. Thirdly, the reclamation of the land, the reclamation or the restoration of the land. And let's look at Isaiah chapter 35, Isaiah 35 verses 1 through 2, and we'll read verse 7 as well. Isaiah 35, 1 through 2, it says, the wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as a rose. Now, one thing I want you to know this, is that throughout the history of Israel, when Israel was dispersed throughout the nations around the world, the land never produced for any conquering army that went into their land. It never produced for them. Because God wanted the land to lay fallow. And indeed, one of the reasons why the Arabs sold the land to the Jewish people when they returned to the land before Israel even became a nation. When a Zionist in the early 1900s left Europe and went to the land of Israel, they sold this, because they looked at those land, it was like a swampy, you know, mosquito infested places, and they even laughed, how can these people just simply want this land so much? It didn't produce for them, didn't produce for any of the other nations that had conquered the land, and we'll go through them in a few minutes. But the point here is that it says the wilderness and the solitary place shall be glad for them. Glad why? Because the people who owned the land had returned. And the desert shall rejoice and blossom as a rose. You go to Israel today, it produces fruit of all kinds. And it just amazes me what you see when you go to the land in terms of the production, what the soil, the land is producing for the people. Can you believe that Israel sends flowers to Europe? Export flowers and fruit and other vegetables to Europe. Can you imagine when it was a desert, a solitary, swampy place? Because God said that it would be that until the people return. Next verse. And it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given unto it, the excellence of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellency of our God. Let's go to verse 7. And the parched ground shall become a pool, and the thirsty land springs of water. In the habitation of dragons, where each lay, shall be grass with reeds and rushes. God prophesied it. This is 750 years before Jesus even came. So you can add 2,750 years ago. God said this will happen, and it has happened. The land has been reclaimed. Israel is a fruitful place indeed today. Let's go to another reason why we believe there is evidence to prove that everything that had to occur has happened indeed for us to look forward to the rapture very soon. And that is the reoccupation of Jerusalem. And I want you to look at Luke chapter 21, verse 24. We mentioned that May 14th, 1948, Israel became a nation. But even though it was established, the capital of Israel, which is Jerusalem, was not part of Israel at the time. It was still under the control of the kingdom of Jordan. And so it took the Six-Day War of 1967 for what I'm about to read here to happen. It says that, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led away captive. This is Jesus speaking here, all right? It is the Jewish people will be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles. Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles. Means that the Gentiles will occupy Jerusalem until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. So the only way you can know that the times of the Gentiles have been fulfilled is if indeed Jerusalem comes back into the hands of the Jewish people, whereas it had been in the hands of the Gentiles. A Gentile, somebody who's non-Jewish. You follow? And in the war of Six-Day War of 1967, Israel recaptured Jerusalem from the Gentiles, from the Arabs, from Jordan. And by that, they have held on to this city, Jerusalem, until recently, when the United Nations again made a resolution, passed a resolution saying that the Jerusalem should not be in the hands of Israel, it should go into the hands of the Muslims, the Arabs, because they're looking at the Arabs occupying it. By 1967, Arabs held on to it. That's true. But Jesus said that a time will come when the Arabs or the Muslims or the Gentiles, period, their days or times of treading down, walking over, controlling Jerusalem will end. And it ended when Israel captured Jerusalem. Now the whole world is saying, no, because the Muslims had it by 1967. Let's go to the pre-1967 time. And if you go back to that time, who had it? The Arabs, the Gentiles had it. And Jesus said the time will come, the Gentiles will not have it any longer. Do you believe the Bible? If you believe the Bible, that's what God Jesus is saying here. And Jesus is our Lord and Savior. He always told the truth. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. Now, so we know now that this matter, let's go to Zechariah chapter 12. Zechariah chapter 12. And let's look at verses 2, 3, 6. Zechariah 12, chapter 12, verses 2, 3, 6. Zechariah. Okay. It says, behold, I will make Jerusalem a cup of trembling unto all the people round about, when they shall be in the siege both against Judah and against Jerusalem. Next. And in that day will I make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people. This is God speaking here. He will make Jerusalem a burdensome stone for all people. All that burden themselves with it shall be cut in pieces. That's God saying that. Though all the people of the earth be gathered against it. And that's what happened in the United Nations on December 23rd of last year. All the nations of the earth, including the United States. If God says all the nations of the earth, all the nations of the earth, including the United States, say that Jerusalem should go back to the Muslims, go back to the Arabs. And God says all those people who burden themselves with it will be cut into pieces. Let's go to verse 4 quickly. And that day said the Lord, I will smite every horse with astonishment and his rider with madness, and I'll open mine eyes upon the house of Judah and will smite every horse of the people with blindness. Now, sometimes when you read this and you know what is going on politically around the world, it just doesn't seem like it's fair. God is not fair. The Arabs have been... Fine, let's go back. Go to Daniel chapter 2 and let's pick up... Where do I want to start? Daniel chapter 2. Let's pick up verse 15. Let's start from there. I don't want that. I want to go quickly. We got a lot to cover before. Let's pick up from verse 31. Daniel 2:31. Okay, thou, O king, saw us, and behold, a great image. This is Daniel seeking to interpret the dream that Nebuchadnezzar had. You remember the story? If you've been to Sunday school as a child, I'm sure that you were taught this growing up about the image, the dream that Nebuchadnezzar had. He said, thou, O king, sawest, and behold, a great image. This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. Next. The image head was of fine gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass. It's interesting, you know, Nebuchadnezzar had a dream, and he said, and he wanted his so-called, wise men, to be able to tell him what the dream was, and then give him an interpretation. And the wise men said, well, you just tell us the dream, and we'll give you the interpretation. If you really are wise, tell me the dream that I had, and then give me an interpretation. What does that? Because he knew that if those people were given the dream, they would find a way to interpret it some kind of way. So I said, I'm not going to give you what I saw. Just tell me what I saw in my dream. If you're able to do that, you're wise. If not, I'm going to kill all of you. Can you imagine that? And so, of course, Daniel was considered one of the wise men. And so that means Daniel had to. And so Daniel asked for time to see God, and he sought God. And so God gave him the dream, and so describing the dream to Nebuchadnezzar and telling him all this. Next verse, quickly. Oh boy, his legs of iron, his feet a part of iron, part of clay. Next. Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and break them to pieces. I'll explain that to you in a minute. Next. Then was the iron, the clay, and the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer, threshing floors, and the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the coming kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in the millennium. We'll talk about it later. Next, quickly, verse 36. This is the dream, and we will tell the interpretation thereof before the king. See, he tells him the dream, and then he's about to tell him the interpretation of the dream. Okay, next. He said, thou, O king, art a king of kings, for the God of heaven hath given thee a kingdom, power, and strength, and glory. Next. And wheresoever the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of the heaven, that he hath given unto thy hand, and hath made thee ruler over them, thou art this head of gold. Remember, the image showed an image with a head of gold. And he's telling the king, you are the gold. I know he was eating it up, right? Thou art this head of gold. Next verse. And after thee shall arise another kingdom inferior to thee. And that kingdom that rose inferior to the kingdom of Babylon was the kingdom Medes and Persia. I'm sure you heard about Persia, right? Persia is Iran today. Iran has been a world power. This is the reason why it's still thinking that it's capable of being a world power again. And so the next kingdom that came after this Babylonian kingdom was the Medes and Persia. And, another third kingdom of brass. And that kingdom that came after that brass kingdom was the Grecian empire, or the Greek empire, led by the man who took my name, Alexander the Great. And so Alexander the Great conquered the world. That's the third kingdom, which shall bear rule over all the earth. Next verse. And the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron. And that fourth kingdom is the Roman Empire. Okay? For as much as iron breaketh in pieces, and there was no empire until America that was that powerful militarily around the world. It says, and the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron, for as much as iron breaketh in pieces and subdueth all kings, and as iron that breaketh all these, shall it break in pieces and bruise. Next. And whereas thou sawest the feet and toes, this is the last kingdom now, the last Gentile kingdom. Now, Daniel is telling Nebuchadnezzar, these are all the kingdoms that will come and rule the world, beginning with the Babylonian kingdom, then followed by Medes and Persia, followed by the Greek Empire, followed by the Roman Empire. And the last one, it says, the fifth one, thou sawest the feet and toes, part of potter's clay and part of iron. The kingdom shall be divided, but that shall be in it for the strength of the iron, for as much as thou sawest the iron mixed with my miry clay. Now, this is the kingdom that is believed to be the holy, renewed Holy Roman Empire. And this renewed Holy Roman Empire will be what Europe, you know, the Roman Empire was basically centered in Europe. And so there will be a renewed European Empire. We know what is going on in Europe now. But interestingly enough, it says iron will be mixed with clay, which means that in one sense it will be powerful. In another sense, it will not have the kind of might and strength as the old Roman Empire had. Because under the emperors of Augustus and Caesar and others, nobody could oppose those emperors. Whereas in today, because of democracy, it's very difficult to make a statement and let it stick. Like Trump said, we don't want anybody coming in. And the judge said, no, you can't. And the judge, you know, overruled him as it is. I know you're probably following the story now. And that's an example of mixing iron with clay. Because in democracy, you know, you can't have the total and complete authority and power as it was the case under the Roman Empire. All right, so quickly, let's move on. And as the toes of the feet were part of iron, part of the clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken, as I just shared with you. Next, quickly. And whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. Okay? All right? And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom. It's interesting. When you see the last kingdom, which is the Holy Roman Empire, which is the old Roman Empire being renewed, being restored, which is the European Union, okay? If you see in the days of these kings, shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom, which means that there's a kingdom coming right after that. If you see this, in the days that you see this, shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom. Are you getting this? All right. Which shall never be destroyed, because all other kingdoms will be destroyed, including even the one that we're talking about in the European Union, European kingdom. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all this kingdom and shall stand forever. And that's the millennial rule that we spoke about several weeks ago. All right. So what I'm sharing with you here is this, that there have been the Gentile rule of this world. You follow? Non-Jewish nations, in fact, it started going back to 2 Chronicles chapter 36, verse 21. Let's look at it. 2 Chronicles chapter 36. 2 Chronicles chapter 36. Are you there? I'll read it to you then. 2 Chronicles chapter 36, verse 21. It says that to fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah, until the land had enjoyed her Sabbaths, For as long as she lay desolate, she kept Sabbath to fulfill 70 years. From that time, when the Israeli nation or the Israelites were conquered by the Babylonians, there had not been a Jewish kingdom that was in control of the Middle East as was under David and Solomon. And so here, the scripture is saying that God wanted, as Jeremiah prophesied, that land would lay fallow for the Sabbath, for the rest. But the key point is from that time then until now, in fact, there will never be a Jewish-Israeli kingdom ever again. And Jesus himself made that point. Let's see what I can find it for him. Go to Matthew chapter 24. And so that we don't think that the Jewish people have it easy or easier, they're going to go through quite a bit in this life in the Great Tribulation. Okay, let's go there. Chapter 24, let's pick up from verse 32. It says, learn the parable of the fig tree. When its branch is yet tender, okay, and put it forth leaves, you know that summer is nigh. So likewise, you then, when you shall see all these things, know that it is near even at the doors. Talking about his coming back. Jesus making reference of his coming back, his return. And go to Luke chapter 21 quickly. And it says the same thing there, talking about, behold the fig tree and all the trees, verse 30, when they now shoot forth, ye see now and know of your own selves that the summer is now at hand. So likewise, when you see these things come to pass, know ye that the kingdom of God is nigh at hand. I just read Luke chapter 21, verse 31. And so my point is that Jesus says, if you see the fig tree shoot up, shoot forth, become operable as a nation. The fig tree always refers to Israel. When you see that, he said, know that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Did you see that? So the point is that God uses Israel as his clock to measure the lease that he's given to man on the face of this earth. We believe that he's given man 6,000 years. I know that it's difficult to suppose that man, you know, because you listen to scientists, they will tell you that the world has been around millions of years. And indeed, they find fossils that, point out to that long of a time. That notwithstanding, we believe that man has been in the earth, according to the Bible, for 6,000 years. We believe that. Now, to say that is to say that does not mean that the world has not been around longer. You get me here? But sometimes people then say the word because the world has been there longer, then man has been here that long as well. God has given us only 6,000 years on the face of this earth, because in the 7,000 year, Jesus will be here. Okay, we have 6 years. If you look at it, 6 is a number for man, and 7 is a number for God. That's why 7 is a perfect number. All right, so we talked about the rapture, that the things that have to happen have already happened. 1, the regathering of Jewish people to Israel. 2, the restoration of Israel as a nation. 3, the reclamation of the land. The land is now working for the Jewish people than ever worked for anybody who conquered the place. 4, that indeed the times of the Gentiles' control of Jerusalem had come to an end, and that happened in 1967. And lo and behold, we are in 2017. And 2017 is a generation, 50 years, a jubilee. Hello. And so praise the Lord, that if something is going to happen, this is it. Now, we are not setting time, because I don't know the time when the Lord will show up. But I know the season is really around. We are in that season for it. We can tell that we are in the season for it because 50 years, the Jubilee in Israel, they're going to be celebrating Jerusalem as 50th year Jubilee. They are just, just excited that they've been able to hold on to this city for 50 years. Is it they're celebrating the Jubilee? Jubilee is the year that you return everything to the people who had it before. The year that you let slaves go. The year that you let people who owe you money go. Isn't that good if we had it here in America? Oh, glory be to God. The year of Jubilee. You call the banks and you tell the banks, this is the year of Jubilee. We wipe the slate clean, praise the Lord. It would be real wonderful. That's how it was supposed to be. Now, because the Jewish people didn't do that in the land. This is what God drove them out of the land. So the land has to have its Sabbath, its Jubilee, its rest. If you don't do it, I'm going to send you, scatter you. And that's what he did. But they have come back, and for the first time in 50 years, they're going to celebrate 50 years of this city, Jerusalem, being in the hands of the Jewish people. Can you imagine? Now, people say, well, let's give it back to the Muslims because they had it before 1967. But if you did that, when Jesus comes, he's coming to a land where Jewish people control. Are you getting me here? We'll come. Now, the rapture will happen when not everybody will see Jesus. But when he comes again, all eyes will see him. That's the difference. In the rapture, only those of us who are believers will see Jesus. But in the second coming of Jesus, all eyes will see. Go to Revelation chapter 1, verse 7, quickly. Revelation 1, 7, and show you the difference between the two. Revelation 1, 7 says that, behold, he cometh with clouds. We sing that song a lot. Behold, he comes. Okay? Behold, he comes with clouds, and every eye shall see him. Thank God for iPhones and or iPads. Every eye will see him. And they also which pierced him. And who were the ones who did that? In the Jewish people in Israel. Who? All eyes will see him, and they also which pierced him. And all kindreds of the earth shall wail, man, weep till you lose it. Like you go to an African funeral, people just pass out. Wail, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, what? Amen. Now, let's move on. So, let's move from the rapture. After the rapture happens, then the world gets in, this earth gets into what is called the Great Tribulation. 7 years of terrible, terrible, terrible things that will happen on the face of this earth. So let's go over some of the things I shared with you earlier. What are the in the tribulation? What can we expect in the Great Tribulation? Of course, you and I will not be here. There's nobody who is a member of this church. If you are here after the rapture, I did something wrong. I don't want you to be here. And the only way, and this is the reason why we always stretch our hands to say Jesus is Lord. The Bible says, anyone who says Jesus is Lord shall be saved. And so every day we're saying that, we are confirming that we are saved people, born again people. Now, because we're going to live here. Somebody will come over to this building on Sunday morning to try to come to church and find no one else here. And they'll be wondering, what happened to these people? Maybe that African preacher took them back to Africa. Oh, no, we went to heaven, praise the Lord. But anyway, let's talk about the Great Tribulation. It is a specific period, of trouble, suffering for all the people in the world. Specific period. And what is a specific period? The specific period begins right after the rapture. And so it will be a countdown of 7 years. Countdown of 7 years of the worst times that this world will ever go through. Can you imagine? Can you really imagine how it is that we had the First World War, the Second World War, we had the Civil War, all sorts of wars that happened on the face of this earth. We've had pestilences of all types, the bubonic plague that hit Europe in the Middle Ages, and all the so-called Ebola virus and others. None of those things that we know before historically that have happened can compare to what is about to happen in this world. Well, let's go over it. It will be worldwide. This tribulation will be worldwide. That's number one. Every place will feel it. It will be the worst time, too. Worst time and affliction and distress ever in human history. The worst time of affliction and distress ever to occur in human history. It will be a terrible time of suffering. And it will also be a period dominated by the man of sin, whom we know to be the Antichrist, right? I'll spend some more time on him in a little bit. During this time, among the Jews and Gentiles will be those who believe in Jesus Christ and are saved. And so even during this period, some people will get saved, Jews and Gentiles as well. Which means that the Holy Ghost will still be working, because he's the only one who can bring anyone to Christ, who takes us all to God the Father. It will also be a time of great suffering and dreadful persecution for all who remain faithful to God. If you remain faithful, you will be persecuted in ways that will be beyond anything that anybody can imagine. If you saw how the 21 Coptic Christians were beheaded on the beaches of Libya about 3 or 4 years ago, imagine that being a daily thing. That's what they can expect to happen. It will be a time of God's wrath and judgment upon the ungodly. Now, let's look at Revelation chapter 6. And let's look at verses 16 through 17. I hope I'm not frightening anybody. This is not for you. You should not be frightened. This is not for you. This is for those people who refuse to accept that Jesus is Lord. This is not for you at all. And so, you know, I don't want you to think that you should be frightened by all this. No, I will not ever minister a message of fright and fear and intimidation. That's not God. But you just must know what is about to happen. And so that if you find somebody who's not born again, you might be able to share with them the importance of getting saved so they can avoid it. There are people who are playing in church, playing all kinds of things. They have made themselves connected to God through Jesus Christ by affirming and confirming who they are in Christ Jesus. And you may be able to help them as you let them see what I'm sharing with you. In fact, give them the CD. Let them listen to it themselves, and hopefully that will sway them. And let's go up a little bit. Go to verse 14. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. If God said it, it's going to happen. Amen. Next verse. It says that, and the kings of the earth, the presidents and prime ministers and, of course, kings as well, and the great men and the rich men and the chief captains, the generals, and the mighty men and every bond man and every free man hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains. Next. And said to the mountains, rocks and rocks, fall on us. And hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. And who is the Lamb? Who is the Lamb?
Jesus.
Next verse. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? There's a reason why we want everybody to understand that day is coming. Now, when I read the Bible, I believe it. I just believe it. Some people say, well, you can spiritualize it. Oh, no. Well, it is literal. Be literal with it. Hello? And so the Bible says, the great day of his wrath has come, and who shall be able to stand it? I don't want to be one of those that want to be here to stand it. Hello? I want to be in heaven. Okay? And so the tribulation is coming, and during the tribulation, there will be pestilences. A pestilence is like a plague. And I mentioned the Ebola virus, plagues and diseases that they have no cure for. And it will spread. So let's look at some of this. Go to chapter 6 there. Let's start from verse 1 for sake of time. And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder and of the four beasts saying, come and see. Next. And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow. And a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer. Okay, next. And when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, come and see. Now, conquer and conquer means there will be wars. Jesus said, again, if you go to Matthew chapter 24, he talks about, or Luke chapter 21, he talks about what will happen in the last days, that a nation will rise against a nation, a kingdom against a kingdom. And that's what we just read in Revelation chapter 6, verse 2. And verse 3 says, and when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, come and see. Next. And there went out another horse that was red. The first one was white, this one is red. And power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another, and was given unto him a great sword. Okay? Again, war continuing. Next verse. And when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, come and see. And I beheld, and lo, a black horse, and he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. Next. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, a measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny, and see thou heard not the oil and the wine. Now, it is going to be, and this is the period where there will be such great famine in the earth. We'll read on, we'll see in the next verse. And I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, come and see. Next. And I looked and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on it was death and hell. Remember, we'll cover that. About 2 weeks ago, I talked to you about heaven and hell. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth to kill with sword and with hunger, you see that, and with death and with the beasts of the earth. That was lions and tigers would just go out and just go wild. But we will not be here. Praise the Lord. Next verse. And when he opened the fifth seal, I saw another under the altar, the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testament which they held. Next. And they cried with a loud voice, how long, O Lord, holy and true thou, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? These are the people who were martyred during the time of the great tribulation, crying out for revenge. Next verse. And white robes were given unto every one of them, and was said, white robe mean robe of righteousness. And it was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season until their fellow servants also and their brethren that should be killed as they were should be fulfilled. God has a time when he will begin the avenging by his wrath against those who have been antichrist. Next verse. And I beheld when he had opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake. And the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. Next. And the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. This is all people talking about global warming. This will fit in very much so. Oh, it's because of global warming. And then God did this. Hello? God did this. He's telling everybody that the time is coming. I just want to let everybody know that I'm God. There are people who refuse to accept him as he is, but God will do things that will leave no doubt to everybody. Next verse, quickly. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And listen to the last one. We read this earlier, but I just want you to see this. Next verse 15. And the kings of the earth and all of those people said, and they are saying, verse 16, the rocks to fall upon them. Go to verse 16 quickly because of time. And said to the mountains, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that is sitting on the throne. Why couldn't they? Instead of saying, fall on us, why couldn't they say, we accept you? Do you hear this? Why couldn't the same mouth, the same tongue, the same lips, the same energy, the same strength that they are using to call for the rocks to fall upon them, they could use it to call upon the name of the Lord? These are people who are so totally given to not accepting Jesus as their Lord and Savior. That's the reason what is coming upon them will come upon them. All right. So that is the tribulation, which will end with the war. I'm sure you heard about the Armageddon war, the war of Armageddon. And that war is a final war where a whole lot of people will lose their lives. Let's move on to now, after the Great Tribulation, the second coming of Jesus. We said that after this, Jesus will have to come back to the earth. Why? Because the Bible says if he did not come back, nobody will remain alive. The people on the earth, not those of us in heaven, we're already up there. But if he didn't come back, there would be no one left on earth. Because nuclear weapons are going at each other. Nations are firing one to another. There's pestilence. There's famine. There are earthquakes. Just name it. Everything terrible is happening. People are dying. You couldn't even have time. The Bible speaks of the war of Armageddon over in Israel, that when that happens, that it would take seven good months to bury the dead. Can you imagine? And so the key here is just to understand that we're really dealing with something that all of us want to avoid. So praise the Lord. All of us want to avoid. And as I said, this is my last teaching on this, and we're going to get back to the usual messages that we have. But the Lord instructed me to do this, and so I've been on for the last 5 weeks. Now, let's talk about the millennium. What is going to happen in the millennium? I'm almost done because I'm told that I'm done. The second coming, we go to heaven. The rapture, we go to heaven, I should say. And the second coming, we come back from heaven. But when we get to heaven, this is what is going to happen. There's what is called the judgment seat of Christ. This is the time that Jesus will reward us, believers, with rewards for what we have done in our bodies. I was saying to you here 2 weeks ago, or I think it was last week rather, when I taught on this, that the only thing we do for Jesus is what we'll be rewarded for. There are a lot of things that we do as a civic, social, political, religious, even, deed or act that will have no bearing of any harvest or reward to us. As good as it is. And that's the reason why some people think that somebody has done some good things in life and they should be rewarded for their good. No. Only what Jesus instructed you to do and you did in his body, in this case in this church, will he reward you for it. Are you getting me here? Amen. And so here are the things that he said that he will reward us for. One is the crown of life. The crown of life is for those who are killed for the sake of the gospel, which none of us here hopefully we'll never have to go through that. Then there is a crown of righteousness that is given to all of us who are believers, who have accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Three, then there's a crown of rejoicing. This crown of rejoicing is for soul winning crown. Those who actually step out there and share Jesus and witness unto others and bring, can you think of yourself of having brought somebody to Jesus ever since you got saved? Can you actually say that since I've been born again, I've led one more person to Christ? If you haven't done, get on with it. Because there's a crown of rejoicing for those who witness and lead someone to Christ Jesus. Oh, praise the Lord. If you haven't done it, do it. Then there's a crown of glory. The fourth crown. The crown of glory. And this crown of glory is for pastors. And pastors who are about the business of pastoring. Who, number one, teach the word. Number two, are the ones who not only are examples for the sheep, but also are the ones who make sure that they don't teach error, nor teach human philosophy, nor teach anything that has a tendency of not producing faith in the people of God. Also, pastors who pray for their sheep, intercede on their behalf. And then finally, the pastors who see to it that if one sheep is missing, that like Jesus said, that they will give up on the 99 and go after the one. And I think on all of those fronts, myself and Pastor Clarissa are seeking to do all of them. That's why we pick up the phone and call you when we don't see you. Because we're trying to get this crown. You may not come. You may not come after we tell you to come, but that's okay. We've done our part. And not only that, we want to make sure that we teach you the word. Nothing is more important to me than teaching the word. Nothing is more important. I got to make sure that indeed, because you know, listen, if I teach error, the mouth that speaks it, it's also the heart that receives it. And so I am really poisoning myself if I were to teach error to you. I'm receiving the same. So it has to be good enough for me as well. So that is the reason why I often make it a point to make sure that I have the scriptures to match what I'm saying, to convince you that what I'm saying to you comes from the Bible. Some of the places, they would just take one verse and that's it. And talk about this, and before you know it, they're into something else. And you leave, you don't know what you got. But what I want to make sure that if you came here and I said that this is what God is saying, I can prove to you by scripture what God said. So in that regard, faith can come to you. Oh, praise the Lord. So there's a... hallelujah. So there's a... so there is a crown of glory for those of us who are in the ministry to do that. I just didn't finish it. But we've got to move on and go into something else next week. Okay? And so we're on the clock. We're on the clock. It's like the draft day for NFL football teams. We are on the clock. And the Titans are on the clock since we live in Tennessee. And one thing that we're going to say is this. The only thing that we're waiting on is the rapture. Nothing else has to happen for the rapture to occur. It can happen right now. After the rapture, what happens next? Tribulation. Very good. After the tribulation, what happens next? The millennium. Very good. After the millennium, Second coming, we should say. Thank you for paying attention. Who's that? Okay. Yeah, okay, second coming. After the second coming, what happens next? The millennium. After the millennium, then we enter into the kingdom without end, which is our Lord and Savior Christ, Jesus Christ's kingdom. All right? So praise the Lord. I hope you got something out of this. And we have the CDs for all of them where the detailed information was given. And the day that I ministered on that particular topic, I was just trying to review and bring everything to a closure to this today. And so God bless you. Stand up to your feet. Praise the Lord.